I'm going to share God's grace with someone entitled, If We Have Three Powers, Three Powers. According to Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, which is today's main scripture, it says, I can do all things through Him who strengthens me, right? So, we can do all things through Him who gives us power, right? Gives us power. And the founding pastor, Reverend Aaron Park, explains about the three powers, or three strengths that we should receive as a Christian. But before we go into the main topic, as an introduction, I would like to introduce Luke chapter 24 to you. Luke chapter 24. There, we will be able to read and find the story of two disciples who are going down to Emmaus. The story we are very familiar with, right? However, by the grace of God, Jesus came to them on the way and expound the Bible, expound the word of God that is written in the Bible to them. Thus, they turned around and went back to Jerusalem to be with the people of faith and to serve with their lives, right? To serve God with their lives. So I'll read verse 27 to 29. Of Luke chapter 24, it says, And beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in all the scriptures. And they approached the village where they were going, and he acted as though he would go farther. And they urged him, saying, Stay with us, for it is getting toward evening, and the day is now nearly over. And he went in to stay with them. These two disciples who are going down to Emmaus, they decided to go down to Emmaus because they got disappointed, right? They got disappointed. They got disappointed by the fact that Jesus died, isn't it? Jesus disappeared. Jesus died and gone, leaving them alone in this world. Although before they departed from Jerusalem, they heard the news. They heard the rumor or news that Jesus is risen, but their condition, their spiritual condition, was not ready to receive and ready to believe what they heard and the news about Jesus is risen, right? So we can say that their emotional and spiritual state became dark, isn't it? Their emotional and spiritual state became dark. They decided to go down to Emmaus because things had gotten rough and tough. Since the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, or in the eyes of Jews, since the death of Jesus Christ, the religious leaders and the Jews were looking for to catch the followers of Jesus, isn't it? Followers of Jesus. In order to kill them, in order to punish them, right? The Bible says that the followers of Jesus gathered in one room, locking all the windows and doors, right? That shows that how difficult the situation was and how terrible it was, right? How uneasy it was. So we can say that the situation became dark, or situation became difficult. If we look at verse 29 of Luke chapter 24, it says, it expressed their condition with this phrase that it is getting toward evening. It is getting toward evening. Of course, this is the statement that because they traveled quite long, right? And they spent quite a long time with Jesus on the street. So when they reached the village they want to go, which is Emmaus, right? It already became dark. It already became evening, right? However, it also can allude that the condition of these two disciples, right? The spiritual, emotional, and the surrounding situation became evening, became dark, right? Became dark. The founding pastor, Reverend Aaron Park, through this sermon, he shared his testimony that he once failed his ministry when he began his ministry in the beginning, I never heard it before, but he briefly explained that he was kicked out from the church by two elders, and thus he failed. That was the before he went to pray to get answers from God. So he felt that he failed, and he was useless before God, right? He could not save the young man that who asked for the, what's the difference between the blood of Jesus Christ and the blood of man in scientific way, right? He couldn't answer it properly. I mean, he answered it, but then this young man did not take it, did not receive it, and he just went away. And he was having a difficult time with the church as well. So he went up to these mountains. He said that he went up almost every mountain that is in South Korea to pray to God. He been to many, many mountains, and he prayed to God. And when he reached the Jang'an mountain, the Mount Jang'an, that he started receiving God's answer. But what he said is that when he read this scripture while he was in that difficult moment, right? While he was in that moment of failure and the feeling of a loser, right? All these things, he read this scripture, and all of a sudden, the situation that these two disciples were going down to Emmaus feels like his own situation. That these people, these disciples were getting into the evening, right? Their condition, their spiritual condition, their spiritual state were getting into the evening, getting into the dark, right? And the founding pastor felt exact same, that his condition, his spiritual state, and his emotional state, his physical state, his surrounding, right, is all dark. He's surrounded by darkness. And then he found the light from the Bible, which is the first phrase of verse 29. The Bible says, they urged Jesus, saying, stay with us. Do you see the answer? Do you see the key there? What will you do when evening comes to you? What will you do when darkness comes to you? What will you do when spiritual, emotional, or physical, or surrounding, right, the darkness and difficult moment comes to you? The two disciples were going down to Emmaus teaches us, although that story teaches us that we should urge Jesus Christ to stay with us. That is the answer. When it comes to evening, when it comes to spiritual moment of spiritual darkness, when it comes to physical darkness, right? I mean, the surrounding, the moment of difficulty, we should cry out to Jesus, my Lord, stay with me. Don't go far. Stay with me, right? They urged Jesus Christ, please stay with us. And Jesus stay with them. Amen. And what happened? On the same night, right, before the day breaks, right, they changed their mind and went back to Jerusalem, isn't it? They received the power. They were restored. They received this, wonderful moment of being changed and being renewed and being restored. Why? Because they urged Jesus, please stay with us. My brothers and sisters, we are experiencing the moment of difficulty, moment of darkness, right? And because of this, you may experiencing the moment of spiritual darkness, time of emotional darkness, or time of just, time that you are surrounded by darkness, right? I pray and urge my brothers and sisters, Let's cry out. Let's urge our Lord Jesus Christ to stay with us in this moment of darkness, so that Jesus may restore us. Jesus may re-establish us. Jesus may re-strengthen us. Amen. So that we may stand up again and we may be able to go back to the place filled of the mission, and we may serve God with our lives. Amen. Amen. Right. So that was an introduction. So coming back to three powers that the Christian should receive. Right. So what are these three powers? We all know about these three things. It's according to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13. It says, but now abide faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. Right? We all know this scripture, right? So three powers are faith, the power of faith, the power of hope, and the power of love. Well, we may argue, we may talk about why the faith is power, but because we can do all things who strengthens us, right? So who gives us strength? Who gives us power? In that sense, the faith, hope, and love can be considered as one of the strength or one of the power. So in today's sermon, I would regard them as the power. So power of faith, power of hope, a power of love, or you may understand as strength of faith, strength of hope, and strength of love. So firstly, we must have the power of only faith. We must have the power of only faith. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6. We all know this scripture, right? And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. So the Bible says, without faith, there is no way to please God, isn't it? There is no way to please God. Those who cannot please God fall into nihilism, right? Nihilism. Because they cannot live in true peace and hope that God gives, they become pessimistic on everything. Nihilism, pessimistic, right? Those who do not have faith to please God end up destroying things around them rather than create things or developing things. They blame on system, they blame on community, or they blame on people around them, right? They blame on relationship, and they blame on everything, right? Thus, they destroy system, they destroy community, they destroy people around them, they also destroy relationship. These are the behavior, these are the result of those who do not have faith to please God. If we have the faith to please God, right, we will be very busy just pleasing God, isn't it? If you have something to please your father, right, you will be very busy to please him in front of him, right? Father, I have this candy, I have this toy, or I have this violin, right? Same. If we have faith to please God, we probably are very busy pleasing God all the time. But when we don't have faith to please God, we become nihilism and pessimistic, and we rather blame on everything, and we start destroying everything, right? The founding pastor gave us an example of this sin. From the story that we all know very well. Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23. Verse 39. Luke chapter 23, verse 39. I'll read it for you. And one of the criminals who were hanged there was hurling abuse at him, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. Who was this? This was the criminal on the left, right? This was the criminal on the left. How do we know? We don't know. The Bible doesn't say, right? But always on the right side in the Bible is the righteous side, whereas the left side is always the disobeying and the arrogant side. So we just name them as the criminal on the left and criminal on the right. But we don't know who was on the left and who was on the right, right? So let's say a criminal on the left, right? He was in extreme pain, isn't it? He was not in a sitting on the couch and watching TV, right? He was not watching, you know, drama of Jesus being crucified on that time. He was at the cross with a Jesus cry. All the punishment and pain that Jesus received, the criminals, they received almost exact same, right? They were in extreme pain. He was in extreme pain, yet he opened his mouth to mock Jesus. If you are the Christ, save yourself and save us also. What good does it or did it bring about? What good did it bring about? He opened his mouth and mocked Jesus, right? And considering all the situation, what good did it make? Nothing, isn't it? Nothing. By saying those things, the left side, the criminal on the left, right? What did he gain? Nothing, isn't it? He didn't gain anything. Just like we said that the one who doesn't have faith to please God will destroy things, right, continually. The criminal on the left side, he destroyed everything, right? He destroyed he made himself even more wicked one, right, by opening his mouth. He destroyed the relationship between Jesus and himself. I mean, if there was a potential, right, if there was anything that could be happening, this left side, the criminal on the left, right, he just destroyed it, right? I don't need you anymore, right? If you are the Christ, save yourself and save us, right? Don't even try to talk to me. Don't even try to come to me. Don't even try that if I believe you, you will save me, right? He just destroyed everything. He cuts everything out. This is what the one doesn't have faith do. This is what the one doesn't have faith to please God do. They destroy everything. They destroy everything. On the other hand, Luke chapter 23, verse 40 to 41. Luke chapter 23, verse 40 to 41. But the other answered and rebuking him said, "Do you not even fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." Right? As I said, the criminals on the cross, they were having almost exact same extreme pain, right? One opened his mouth and mocked Jesus Christ, and the other couldn't help it, but he opened his mouth and advocate for Jesus, defend Jesus Christ. Who would do such a thing? Right? Can you do such a thing? If you got a car accident and you start bleeding, right? Can you go around and, to the police, you know what? This one is innocent, right? Would you do this? If your life is almost at the crucial moment, can you just look for a man and look for police and says that this man is innocent, this man did not do anything wrong, right? Can you do that? Who would do such things if it is not done by faith, right? If it is not done by faith. The criminal on the right side, he believed in Jesus, right? He believed in Jesus. He know and believe that, Jesus is God himself, right? From Jesus, there is salvation. If it wasn't the faith, how he could do such things? So, dear my brother and sister, our Lord Jesus is with us today. Amen?
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus is with us today and forevermore. Our Father God is with us today and forevermore. Not only when there is no COVID-19, not only when your business is going well, not when only your body is healthy, right? Everything is going well. But when everything is not going well, our Lord Jesus is with us. Our Father God is with us, right? If the two disciples going down to Emmaus got disappointed because they cannot see Jesus Christ anymore, right? Then I urge my brothers and sisters, let's not get disappointed. And let's open our eyes. Let's not become the criminal like the one on the left side, but let's become the criminal like the one on the right side who opened the spiritual eyes and recognize Jesus. See Jesus, right? Let's see Jesus today. Revelation chapter 1 verse 8. Revelation chapter 1 verse 8. It says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Right? So God is Alpha and Omega, which means what? God was at the beginning, God will be at the end, right? God is there to what? To protect us. God is there to take care of us, right? As I said, even in the time of the plenty, right? God was there to take care of us. Even in the time of difficulty, most difficulty, God will be there to take care of us. So, my brothers and sisters, let's believe that God is here and God will be here with us. John chapter 8 verse 29. John chapter 8 verse 29. It says, and he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone. For I always do things that are pleasing to him. See? Are you not sent by God? Amen? Amen. We are sent by God, isn't it? We are chosen by God. We are called out by God. We are sent by God. Therefore, God is with us. Amen? Right. Secondly, we must have the power of eternal hope. We must have the power of eternal hope. Right. God created eyes for mankind. For what? To see, right? To see. Of course, if you have eyes, means that you have to see, right? So God created eyes because there are things that we must see. Right? Not only physical things, but the God, when God creates mankind, right, he create eyes, right? Means that spiritually speaking, physically speaking, there are things that we must see, right? We must see. Likewise, because there are things to expect, because there are heart of desire, right? Heart of expectation in mankind. Why? Because there are things that we should hope for, right? We should hope for. The reason why we have the desire, the reason why we have the heart of hope, right? The reason why we have this heart of expectation is because there are things that we must hope for continually, right? We must hope for continually. God gave us the heart of eternal hope that longs for eternal world, eternal world. This desire cannot be satisfied with the things of this world. But the things above, things unseen, and things eternal. Right? Because we are hoping, we have the hope for eternity, right? The temporal things cannot satisfy us. That desire only can be satisfied by eternal things, or the things above, or things unseen. Right? 2 Corinthians, chapter 4 verse 18, 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 18. He says, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Right. The reason why mankind has desire, right, is to see this eternal thing. Of course, as time goes by, as we live, right, we forget what it's supposed to do, right? what's the main purpose of desire being in our heart? So we use for something else, right? We use for success. We use for great achievement. We use for, you know, good marriage. We use for, you know, great income, right? We use for other things. But what I'm saying is that God created the desire in the mankind, right? Because God wants us to look for and hope for eternal things and things unseen, things eternal. And the Bible, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18 says, things which are seen are temporal. They cannot satisfy that specific desire, right? That the fundamental desire cannot be satisfied. We always use this illustration, right? That, oh, I have a desire of having 1 million ringgit in my bank account. So finally, by God's grace, that you gain 1 million ringgit and you got 1 million ringgit in your bank account. Then will you be satisfied forever from that time onward? No, right? Maybe for seconds, right? Maybe for a minute, right? But immediately, what do you think? How can I have 2 million ringgit, right? How can I have 10 million ringgit? How can I have 100 million ringgit, right? But immediately, when we have 1 million ringgit, our hope, our heart is not satisfied, but we get more greedy, right? So with the things temporal, with the things sin, cannot satisfy our desire, the true desire, right? Our true desire only can be satisfied things unseen, which is eternal. Romans chapter 8 verse 24. Romans 8 verse 24. It also says, for in hope we have been saved. But hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one also hope for what he sees? Of course, we can understand initially what it means is that we hope for what we cannot see, what we don't see at the moment. So if you have if you have 100 ringgits in your pocket, right? We don't hope to get 100 ringgits because it's already in your pocket, right? We don't hope for what we see at the moment, right? Oh, I would like to have a laptop, right? But I got the laptop, right? So we don't hope for what we already have or what we already can see, right? We may hope for, I want to have a BMW, I want to have a, you know, Bentley, I want to have a luxurious condo, right? That we don't have at the moment, right? That we cannot see at the moment. Right? So initial understanding is that the hope is something that we desire that we don't have at the moment or we don't see at the moment. But ultimately, what we can understand is, as I said, the things on earth is all temporal, right? Even the greatest laptop, even the greatest BMW, even the most luxurious condo, they are all temporal, they are all going down, they are all going to ruin. Our desire only can be satisfied the things unseen, things above, that is, the kingdom of God. Mankind, God puts this desire, longing for the kingdom of God in our heart. That is the reason for the desire. Not to become greedy, but to long for the kingdom of God. Long for God Himself, who is Spirit, therefore, who is unseen, right? Who is invisible. God puts desire that mankind should long for Himself, God Himself, and the kingdom of God. To desire to enter New Jerusalem, right? So reference, 2 Corinthians 5 verse 7. You can see the references there, right? So you can write them down and read it all. So the hope, right, that God gave, or the eternal hope that God gave to us is to long for the kingdom of God. And I'm sure that you are all here in the Lord's Covenant Church because you have such hope, isn't it? Is there anyone who do not long for the kingdom of God? Is there anyone who do not long to enter New Jerusalem at the end? No, right? Everyone looks and everyone desires to enter the New Jerusalem and to the kingdom of God. Then let me ask you another way. Are we always in that hole? 24 hours? 365 days? Are we always in that hole? If you are, I bless you and I admire your faith. But some of us may not be, isn't it? When things are going well, we really in that hole, right? When we really receive grace of God and fill in the word of God and the grace of God, we long for the kingdom of God. But the moment that things are not going well, we are so stressful, you know, we are so depressed and we just lost. Oh, what's the kingdom of God? I don't have even food to eat tonight. So why is our hope at times become weak? Why is our hope at times being shaken? The Bible answers, it is because we don't have the love of God. Romans chapter 5 verse 5. It is because we don't have the love of God. Romans chapter 5 verse 5. I'll read it for you. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Right? So if we understand this scripture, hope does not disappoint, right? When the love of God has been poured out within our heart. If the love of God is in our heart, hope never disappoints us, right? Hope never leaves us, right? We don't lose hope, right? But we do lose hope, and hope does disappoint us. Why? When we lack, when we lost the love of God, when we lost the love of God. Only when we truly love our Father God, when we truly love our Lord Jesus Christ, when we truly love the Holy Spirit, we will naturally desire for the kingdom of God, and we will continually desire to stay with Him. Isn't it? If you don't love our Father God, would you desire to be with Him? No, isn't it? We may have it as an option, right? Option A, option B. Oh, it's good to have stay with God, right? But when we truly have when we truly love our Father God, then the desire naturally, right? The burst out from your heart. Right? I really want to be with our Father God. I really want to see Him once again. I really want to touch Him. I really want to talk to Him, right? When the love of God is there, right? That we will not lose the hope. We will not lose the eternal hope. We will not lose the hope that we are longing for the eternal kingdom and, entering New Jerusalem. So, my brothers and sisters, let's have this love of God. Let's have this love toward God, right? So that we always continually desire and have a hope, this eternal hope of eternal kingdom and His house, His temple, right? But another thing that we can talk about the hope is Ephesians chapter 4 verse 4. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 4. Yeah, we are talking about the same hope at the moment, right? Eternal hope that is longing for the eternal kingdom or God Himself, right? Let's look at Ephesians chapter 4 verse 4 with that understanding. There is one body and one spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling. The Bible says you or we are called in one hope. One hope. That one hope is eternal hope that we talked about, right? The longing for eternal kingdom and the longing for God Himself. God says that you, all of you, my people, right? You are called in one hope, one same hope. Therefore, we are fellow workers, right? Therefore, we are fellow workers. Therefore, we are one family. Therefore, we are brothers and sisters. Then why do we fight in the church? right? If we are fellow workers, if we are called in one duty, one hope, right? Why do we fight each other in the church? Do not divide the party in the church. In the world, there is my side, my gang, your side, your gang, right? But in the church, there is no division between my gang and your gang. My side and your side, right? There is no such thing. Whether we have many or little, whether we are educated or not, whether we are Greek or Jews, whether we are Korean or Malaysian, right? Whether we are Singaporean or Japanese, whether we are, male or female, right? We must be one in Christ Jesus. We must be one in Christ Jesus. Let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8. Therefore, I want the man in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and dissension. In the church, in the community of faith, there shouldn't be any division. There shouldn't be any fight. That is something that God does not like. God is not pleased with. 1 John 3, verse 3. 1 John 3, verse 3. And everyone who has this hope fixed on him purifies himself just as he is pure, right? Purifies himself. We have to purify ourselves. We have to purify our thoughts and behavior in the church. No division, my brothers, sisters, right? I know there is no division in our church. I thank God for it, right? And there is no fight, there is no argument. And I really thank God for it, right? But do not, please remember, God won't be happy to see the church being divided and fight each other. So pray that you and I never encounter such madness. We may never be part of such madness. Amen? Amen. Also remember that our hope should be in God only, right? God only. So that's the eternal hope. Thirdly, the power of perfect love. Agape love, right? Power of perfect love. Right, this is how the founding pastor explains. For the one who doesn't have the love of Jesus, love will be changed to hatred. Let me say again. For the one who doesn't have the love of Jesus, love will be changed to hatred eventually. And hatred will turn into love. And loath creates enemy. And if you have a lot of enemies around you, you will feel unsafe and anxiety all the time. It will lead to depression and darkness eventually. Can you see the flow here, right? Don't have love, hatred, loath, enemy, and then that creates unsafe feeling and anxiety, and then that leads us to depression and darkness. This is what is written in the book of Jude. Book of Jude. So if you read the book of Jude, you will see this flow in the Bible. So we must have the power of perfect love, that is agape love, God's love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 to 7 explains about love. Shall we read it together? Can you see the screen? I'm sure you can even recite it by heart. But let's read it together. Ready? Begin. Love is patient. Love is kind. And is not jealous. Love does not brag. And is not arrogant. Does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Does not take into account a wrong suffered. Does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoice with the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Amen. How much of love or perfect love we are having at the moment, or we are practicing at the moment, according to comparing to this 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 to 7. Do you Are you be patient forever? Are you patient? Are you patient? Can you endure till the end? Are you kind all the time? Maybe sometimes, right? But then if someone pokes you, someone provokes you, right? The kindness is gone, right? You know who, let me show you who's the boss here, right? It's really difficult to practice this love. Right? It's really difficult. But this is the love that God defines, isn't it? This is the love that God defines. And this is the love that God wants us to practice and live by. Such love only can be performed by the one who have the absolute faith in Jesus. Right? Such love can only be performed by the one who have the absolute faith in Jesus. This love is more powerful. If this kind of, if such love is practiced, right? This perfect love is more powerful than any hatred, any loath, any depression, any enemy, or any revenge, any vengeance. Right? I mean, look at it. Love is patient, love is kind, right? If you be kind all the time, if you endure it till the end, right? Even the enemy comes and provoke you, but nothing else comes up but love, right? So love is more powerful. Love is more strong. Love is stronger than anything, right? And such love can only be performed by the one who have the absolute faith in Jesus Christ. Right, dear my brothers and sisters, in this moment of difficulty, we didn't forget the house of God. We came to His sanctuary to serve God and give our worship to Him today. I can see many faces of you. And as I am glad to see your face, I believe that God is more pleased to see your faces today. Out of love of God, I'm sure that you came to the church and served by faith. And hopeful eternal kingdom of God be present today. Amen. Therefore, do you think that God will ignore us and lead us to perish? Never, never, right? God will remember you and me today, and He will pour out His great blessings upon you and me, upon the Lord's Covenant Church, and upon your families, and upon Malaysia. Amen? Amen. So remember that the power of faith, power of love, power of hope, right? And keep practicing these powers in our lives, that God's blessing may be always continually overflowing upon your head, upon your family, upon whatever you do. Amen. Amen. The conclusion today. We must have the Word of God. We must have the Word of God. We talked about the power of faith, hope, and love. And I was surprised to see all this scripture that the faith, hope, and love are all related to the Word of God, Word of God. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. One of the most famous scripture, right? The faith comes from hearing. Hearing by the Word of Christ. So, faith comes from the hearing the Word of God, right? We all know about this, right? Then next scripture, Colossians chapter 1, verse 5. Colossians chapter 1, verse 5. It says, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of which you previously heard in the word of truth, the gospel. Right? Because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of which you previously heard in the word of truth, the gospel. Right? Hope and the word of truth, word of gospel, is related here. Right? And 1 John chapter 2, verse 5. 1 John 2, verse 5. But whoever keeps his word, in him the love of God has truly been perfected. By this, we know that we are in him. Right? Faith comes from hearing the word of God. Eternal hope is the word of truth. And keep the word of God perfects our love. Right? We were talking about, we should have these, we must have these three powers. Power of faith, hope, and love. And how do we going to obtain and gain this power? By the word of God, by receiving the word, by hearing the word of God, by believing the word of God. Therefore, we should hold on to the word of God. We should hold on to the Bible. Read the Bible. Get close to the word of God daily. In the beginning of this year, right, we pledged to read the Bible, right? I don't know how far you are following at the moment, how well you are following, but do not forget. That is not obligation. That is the way to receive God's blessing. The reason why I'm asking you to read the Bible daily is because in that way, God will be pleased with you and God will pour out His blessings upon you. Right? Of course, at the end, we will check who have finished and who have completed, how many times have you completed and things like that. However, that is not the whole reason why I'm asking you to read, isn't it? The more you read, God will bless you more. Right? God will come close to you. So do not forget, especially in the time of this difficulty, right? Let's keep reading the Bible. Let's keep drawing ourselves near to the Word of God. Right. And when evening comes, when evening and darkness comes, cry out to God that His Word be close to you and stay with you. Through this, you may have the powers of true faith, true hope, and true love, and overcome the darkness and all this difficult situation that is around us.